Schönen guten Abend, meine sehr geehrten Damen und Herren. Ich möchte Sie ganz herzlich begrüßen zu unserem 23. Afrika Live Festival. Wir haben dieses Jahr wieder ein relativ vielfältiges Programm zusammengestellt. Sie haben draußen ja schon ein bisschen was mitbekommen, wurde schon ein bisschen was erzählt von dem Rahmenprogramm, was dieses Jahr gezeigt wird. Wir haben zum einen die Ausstellung in Höchst, Telling Stories von Edemba Udem, Emenka Dubem, Emenka Udemba, tut mir leid, die jetzt noch bis Ende Februar zu sehen sein wird. Die Ausstellung wurde gestern eröffnet. Wir haben am Samstag um 15 Uhr die Podiumsdiskussion, warum eine Dekade der UNO für Menschen afrikanischer Herkunft in der ESG. Wir haben wie immer das Kinderfest bei Afroton am Freitag, den 12.02. mit der beliebten Gruppe ADESA. Am 16.02. findet im Y die Lesung mit Donald Walk statt. Und das Abschlusskonzert wie immer in der Brotfabrik am 17.02. Gut, Sie können das alles auch noch nachlesen in unserem Heftchen. Ich wollte es nur einfach nochmal kurz erwähnt haben. Dann möchte ich mich natürlich vor allen Dingen ganz besonders bei unserem Team bedanken. Ein paar haben Sie auch schon draußen kennengelernt. Vielleicht sage ich jetzt einfach noch mal kurz auch die Institutionen, die dahinter stehen. Das ist die Africa Foundation, Afroton, Dialog International und natürlich das Filmforum Höchst der VHS Frankfurt und wir. Als weiteres sind unsere Kooperationspartner auch schon in jahrelanger Zusammenarbeit das Neue Theater in Höchst, wo immer das Eröffnungskonzert traditionell stattfindet, und eben die Brotfabrik, auch schon eine langjährige Zusammenarbeit, wo das Abschlusskonzert stattfindet. Neu ist in diesem Jahr die ESG, die studentische, evangelische Studentengemeinde hier an der Uni, wo die Podiumsdiskussion stattfindet. Also wir haben immer wieder wechselnde Kooperationspartner und gemeinsame Kooperationspartner, und das macht eben auch so ein bisschen den Charme des Festivals aus, dass es immer wieder an unterschiedlichen Orten stattfindet. Und dann natürlich gilt unser besonderer Dank den Unterstützern, den Förderung des Festivals. Das ist zu allem Ding für das Filmprogramm. Insbesondere ist das einmal die Hessische Film- und Medien GmbH. Das war früher die Hessische Filmförderung, die hat sich jetzt umbenannt, die eben einen großen Teil des Filmprogrammes fördert. Dann sind unsere weiteren Kooperationspartner das Institut Français, insbesondere hier in Frankfurt das Institut Franco-Allemand Sciences Historiques et Sociales d'Allemand. Und da möchte ich stellvertretend Dominique Petre begrüßen, die auch schon seit vielen Jahren das Festival unterstützen. Und dieses Jahr kommt eben noch dazu, dass Frankreich dieses Jahr Gastland der Buchmesse ist und in dem Sinne auch noch so ein bisschen in dem Rahmen des Projektes Frankfurt auf Französisch in diesem Jahr steht. Dann möchten wir dem Filmhaus Frankfurt danken, Ralf Förg, dem Friedrichsdorfer Institut zur Nachhaltigkeit. Heute Abend ist Michael Götze da, da hatten wir vorhin auch schon kurz drüber gesprochen, und das hat sich eine Zusammenarbeit, die sich mittlerweile eben auch etabliert hat. Sie findet zum vierten Mal statt, und das freut uns, dass wir eben immer einen Film mit im Programm haben, der sich so im weitesten Sinne um Nachhaltigkeit beschäftigt. Das ist morgen Abend, der Film, möchte ich Ihnen gleich schon ankündigen, La Couleur dans le Vent, in dem es um die Stadt Alit im Süden Nigers dreht, die durch den Uranabbau geprägt ist. Und wir freuen uns ganz besonders, dass wir in diesem Jahr auch die Regisseurin da haben, Amina Vera, die heute Abend schon da ist und die ich hier an der Stelle ganz herzlich begrüßen möchte. Gut, weitere Sponsoren sind das Kulturamt Frankfurt, das Hessische Ministerium für Wirtschaft, Energie, Verkehr und Landesentwicklung, die Landeszentrale für politische Bildung, Brot für die Welt und das Diakonische Werk in Hessen. Ich hoffe, ich habe jetzt keinen vergessen. So, damit ist jetzt dieser offizielle Part auch vorbei. Genau, oder noch ein weiterer Dank gilt der Filminitiative Köln. Das ist ein Partnerfestival, was immer im September stattfindet und die uns dieses Jahr auch mit einigen Filmen beziehungsweise der Übersetzung einiger Filme unterstützt haben. Und deswegen sind einige Filme diesmal auch mit deutschen Untertiteln zu sehen, was normalerweise auch nicht der Fall wäre. Und die wurden unterstützt durch die Bundeskulturstiftung. Das Festival in Köln hatte zum Schwerpunkt im letzten Mal Sisters in African Cinema, einen Schwerpunkt zu Frauen. Wir hatten bereits einen Schwerpunkt zu Frauen bei unserer 20. Ausgabe gehabt. Und auch in diesem Festival gibt es wieder einige Filme von Frauen zu sehen. Und wir haben eben auch zwei Gäste, eben Amina Vera und die Regisseurin des heutigen Abends, Sarah Bleacher, hier. Das zeigt eben, dass Frauen auch in Afrika doch sehr stark vertreten sind, also im Bereich des Films. Auch von anderen Schwerpunkten der vergangenen Jahre haben wir in diesem Programm, greifen wir immer wieder auf diese Themen, die wir in den letzten Jahren bereits hier als Schwerpunkte hatten, zurück. Da will ich vielleicht nur erwähnen, The Revolution Won't Be Televised, der sich um die Revolution in Senegal, um eben die Jean Marais, diese Bewegung handelt. Und der Film zeigt eben auch, wie wir bereits im letzten Jahr einige Filme hatten, wie diese Bewegung angefangen hat, aber geht eben auch über den Umsturz hinaus bis in die heutige Zeit. Als weiteren Film haben wir Mali Blues, auch ein Musikfilm. La Revolution beschäftigt sich auch viel mit Musik. Mali Blues eben auch, der zeigt die Situation in Mali, eben wo die Dschihadisten nach wie vor sozusagen die Musikszene bedrohen. Auch da hatten wir vor 2 Jahren den Woodstock in Timbuktu, der das schon angedeutet hat, und das kommt in diesem Film jetzt auch nochmal sehr stark zum Tragen. Gut, ich kann jetzt nicht auf jeden Film einzeln angehen, ich will aber vielleicht noch einfach ein paar Filme erwähnen von den aktuellen Filmen, die es in den nächsten Tagen hier zu sehen gibt. Das ist Nakom aus Ghana, Kati Kati, das ist ein Film von One Fine Day Films, eine Produktionsgesellschaft von Tom Tykwer, der eben nach Nairobi gegangen ist und dort mit den Leuten vor Ort Workshops macht und Filme dreht. Das ist also auch schon der 4. Film, den wir von dieser Produktionsfirma zeigen, und ist auch sehr sehenswert, weil er so ein bisschen anderen Blick, auch mal ein anderes Thema hat als sonst. Gut, soweit. Genau, wir haben in jedem Jahr eigentlich immer ein Schwerpunktthema. Dieses Jahr ist es nicht ein Schwerpunkt, sondern es sind gleich 2 Schwerpunkte. Ein Fokus liegt auf Migration, wie auch schon draußen gesagt worden ist. Das ist ein Thema, was natürlich irgendwie schon seit vielen Jahren präsent ist, was wir auch immer wieder schon hier in diversen Filmen, auf diversen Festivals gezeigt haben. Aber es ging mir besonders um 2 Filme, die vielleicht ein bisschen andere Perspektive nochmal aufdeuten, weil es eben darum geht, dass die Filme aus der Sicht der Protagonisten gedreht worden sind. Eben Le Sauteur, der auch schon hier in den Kinos lief und der sehr sehenswert ist, wo Aboubakar Sidibé sagen selber die Kamera in die Hand nimmt und seine Situation. Er ist in Melina und Melilla und wartet darauf, dass er die Gelegenheit hat, sozusagen nach Europa oder in die Enklave über den Grenzzaun zu gelangen und eben seine Situation dort vor Ort filmt. Und Live Sarabar Illegal von Peter Heller und Salio Saar, die beide auch am Sonntag hier bei uns und am Montag in Höchst anwesend sein werden. Und wo es auch um Salio Saar sozusagen seine Cousins begleitet. Der eine ist schon aus dem Senegal nach Europa, nach Spanien sozusagen geflüchtet, vor Jahren schon, und hat dort irgendwie wartet dort darauf, dass er sozusagen sein illegaler Status anerkannt wird. Und sein Bruder, der ihm unbedingt folgen wird, obwohl er eigentlich weiß, mit was für Widrigkeiten der Bruder zu kämpfen hat, und trotzdem will er unbedingt auch denselben Weg gehen, und den begleitet sozusagen Salio Saar zusammen mit Peter Heller. Unser 2. Schwerpunkt ist Südafrika, ein Land, mit dem wir uns immer wieder auseinandergesetzt haben, was wir auch schon öfters als Schwerpunkt hatten. Ich glaube, einmal war das 98 und 99, dann 2010, und wir haben die Entwicklung eigentlich immer wieder auch mit Filmen verfolgt. Im Moment ist die Situation so, dass das Land in der, beziehungsweise der ANC in der Krise ist. Zuma ist durch unzählige Korruptionsskandale verwickelt, und auf der anderen Seite gibt es jedoch eine sehr lebendige Filmszene. Es gibt viele unabhängige Filmemacher, also es gibt fast 30 Produktionen im Jahr von unabhängigen Filmemachern, und wir wollen eben einen Blick auf das Land werfen und gucken, wie sich die Filmemacher mit der Situation auseinandersetzen. Ja, und in dem Kontext natürlich läuft jetzt auch unser Eröffnungsfilm, und ich freue mich sehr, dass wir heute Abend Sarah Bleacher hier zu Besuch haben, die ich hier ganz herzlich begrüßen möchte. Sarah Bleacher lebt in Johannesburg, ist Filmemacherin und Produzentin, hat dort ihre Produktionsfirma Singa und produziert und dreht Spielfilme, Dokumentarfilme, arbeitet auch viel fürs Fernsehen und mit Serien. Und sie selber hat mit Dokumentarfilmen angefangen, unter anderem Serving Soweto und was ist es, Kobus und Dumile. Und sie wurde unter anderem auch vom CNC als beste afrikanische Journalistin des Jahres 2002 ausgezeichnet. Sie hat dann den Serving Soweto, daraus hat sie dann ihren ersten Spielfilm auch gedreht, Othello is Burning, der ihr gleich sehr viele Preise einbrachte. Und 2015 hat er gleich zwei Filme dann gleichzeitig rausgebracht, eben Ayanda, den wir heute Abend sehen werden, und Disc E Anna. Und was ich so das Besondere an ihr finde, ist auch, dass sie in jedem Film eigentlich ganz neue Themen aufgreift. Jeder Film ist sehr unterschiedlich zu den Filmen, die sie vorher gemacht hat. Das nächste Projekt, I'm telling, you understand a little bit what I'm telling, so I'm switching to English. And I was telling that your films are very different one from each other, that you always have very different themes that you are coping with. And your new project is about Indians in South Africa, which is also a very interesting theme, I think. So yes, welcome to Frankfurt. We are very glad to have you here tonight. And you want to say just two words, and then we start the film, and after the film, we will have the question answering. So.
I didn't really understand any of that. So if I say something again, I'm really sorry. But so for me as an African filmmaker, I got really very tired of watching always African films that talk about death and poverty and people suffering and people being victims. Because of course in Africa there are victims and there is poverty and there is war and there is all those things. But not everybody in Africa is a victim. And so I think we made this film to show that actually there are normal people in Africa as well. There are people who grapple with normal issues. They grapple with their relationships with their fathers. They grapple with their histories. They grapple with, do you understand? Yeah, okay. But they grapple with just the normal things that everybody in the world grapples with. And that's why we made this film. So please stay for questions afterwards. But yeah, I hope you enjoy.
Thank you. Okay, yes. Thank you for the film. And yes, I will start maybe with some question, and then we open up to the audience. Yes, I think the film is very, very complex, because on the one hand, it's of course the story of Ayanda and her coming out. But on the other hand, there's a lot of other things into it. It's the story, of course, of her family. It's the story of the district. It's the story of the photographer. So yes, maybe what was your first idea when you started to develop the story, the screenplay?
Sure, the first idea. So I think the first idea was really, I think, you know, for those of us that are living in South Africa at the moment, one of the things that I think you realize, and that's so important and tragic actually, is that in a country's history, if you don't deal with the real trauma that happened, and you just sort of sweep over it without actually dealing with it and understanding it properly, then the country gets stuck. It can never move forward. And I think that was the starting idea for the film, to take that story and tell it in a person. So like in Ayanda's life, when her father died, it was something the family never dealt with. It was this trauma that controlled what happened to the family going forward. But only later, when they could go back and understand what happened in that event, were they free to go forward? And I think that's the same thing in South Africa. I think that apartheid has never properly been dealt with by the country. And until apartheid is actually dealt with, the country will remain stuck in a way. I mean, you know, it's funny being in Germany, because I think that out of any country I've ever been in, I think Germany had a traumatic past, but it feels to me like Germany engaged with that past and is still engaging with that past. And I believe that's the only way.
But yes, I always had the impression that also South Africa did a lot to cope with its past, especially in the beginning. I mean, when they had the reconciliation works and all this. So yes, my impression was at that time. But now, yeah, the last years, I think it changed.
You know, I think that's true and not true. I mean, I think reconciliation is a way that lets you move forward. Mm-hmm. But with reconciliation, you can't talk about what just happened. You know, you just have to take a big step past what happened, not actually understand what happened.
Mm-hmm. So yes, I think this comes also more clear, not only the character of Ayanna, but it comes more clear in the character of her mother and maybe also the uncle or Nsuma. That they are really stuck, and they had the hopes in the beginning. They had the hope. Her mother had the ideas about the franchising and a lot of ideas. But then, in this case, it was the death of her husband. But she got really stuck at some point, and she couldn't get out and she couldn't get further anymore. Yes. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yes, also a part which is also very important for the film is the area. It is the district it is taking place. Maybe you can tell a little bit about this also, because I think it's important for the story, and also some very special area, I think, in Johannesburg.
Is anybody from South Africa? No. Yay! So this area in Johannesburg is a place called Yeovil. And in the history of Johannesburg, it's the place where immigrants have always come. So whatever wave of immigrant came to South Africa, settled there, and then made a business, and then moved out into the city. And now it's waves of different immigrants from all over the whole of Africa. So there's one big street that you walk down in the suburb, and if you want, you can find Senegalese food, and then you can find Congolese food and Nigerian food. It's such a melting pot. It's a place. I mean, it's like New York. It's like one of these big cities where everybody mixes together, and the best comes out of all that mixture. So in South Africa recently, we've had a lot of xenophobia. I mean, I think it's the same thing that's going on everywhere in the world. You know, when a government is failing, they need somebody to blame. So they turn around, and who do they blame? They blame the foreigners. And the same thing happened in South Africa, where there was a lot of xenophobia and a lot of foreigners were actually killed. Mozambicans and Somalians were killed. I mean, it was a very terrible, terrible period. It's a bit better now, but it's like resting. It's not gone away. But it was kind of amazing, because in this area, Yeovil, there was, even though it's an area that's filled with foreigners, there was no violence in this place. This was the one place in Johannesburg where there wasn't a single bit of violence. And to me, it's a very hopeful thing, because it's an idea that actually, when you mix people up like this, it works. You know, it's not the tension among the people themselves, it's the tension that comes from outside that causes the problems, in a way.
Are there already questions from the audience? Okay.
Hi. Congratulations on a very, very good film. I quite enjoyed it. My name is Denise. As I mentioned, I am from South Africa as well. I do have a question on two points, the aesthetics, and how would you term the genre of the film? I saw a lot of, it looks very experimental since you added animation, moving picture and photography. So how would you classify its genre and what inspired the aesthetics? Ayanda, as I noticed, is very old Soweto or classic 70s, 80s Soweto. Miriam Makeba, I saw you used some of her music there. So what inspired that aesthetics for that particular, for the protagonist and as well as classifying the genre?
Okay, that's a great question. You know, what I'm noticing with young people in cities like Joburg at the moment are that young people have a lot of access to the rest of the world. You know, with the internet, they can see what's going on in London, they can see what's going on in Berlin, they know what's going on everywhere in the world. And a lot of young creatives in Joburg are trying to take what they want from their cultures. You know, they're many different cultures, and they're taking the things that they like and respect and mixing them with what they see of the rest of the world. It's kind of they call it Afropolitan, which is sort of Africans that can be on the streets of Joburg or the streets of anywhere in the world. And in a way, that's the aesthetic. So the guy who's the photographer in the movie, he plays himself. That's actually him. So all the stuff he says is actually, we did a whole lot of interviews with him, and then we just transcribed the interviews and made him say the lines again. But they're what he does, and in many ways, he inspired the aesthetics. So the way that the characters are all photographed, where they're standing like in the middle of a sort of Instagram-y kind of frame, that's the way, like if you go on the internet and Google him, you'll see all his photographs look very much like that. No, so that was Anthony Biela. He's called the Expressionist. So Trevor Sturman is another photographer who took some of the images that we mixed all together. But Anthony's the guy who's actually the photographer in the movie. So a lot of the aesthetics were inspired by what he does and the way that he sees the Joburg landscape in a way. Does nobody else have a question?
Where is your position as a white South African woman in this film? Because you cannot identify only with this older, dying white woman. And you, as you tell, the aesthetic is the aesthetic from Black South African artist. And so where are you there?
You know, In many ways, this film, for me personally, is made for my daughter. So my daughter's name is Ayanda, so it's the same name as the film. And I think the me in the film is what the message of the film is, which is, you know, it's what I'm trying to teach my daughter. I'm trying to teach my daughter that whatever the issues, you know, in Ayanda's life, it was her father died. Well, my husband is alive, so we don't have that problem. But it's saying that as a young person, if you confront those issues, your life becomes so much easier to live. So if you ask me, where's me? There's me. You know, I mean, so for me as a filmmaker, Yeah, I've made a film about young Zulu boys learning to surf in a place called Durban. And I've made this film, and I've made a film about incest in a white Afrikaans family. So none of these are my culture and me personally, but all of them are my story.
But put it in another way, what would be what you said at the beginning, that and what I understand very well, I worked much in Mozambique and Congo. So what would be to go through the past of apartheid, as we know, the forced reconciliation was a jump which didn't give the time to look on really what happened, but forced to forget it too quickly, which is not to forget. So what would it be to look really on it? What is your idea?
I think that's, you know, that's the real question, and it's a very hard question, and I don't have an answer to that. But we need to, as a country, look at it with proper honesty, you know, and look at it from a position not of emotion, but of understanding, you know, understanding what are the forces that caused that thing and that allowed it to exist, and to ensure that it doesn't exist ever again. And it's complicated and difficult. And in my opinion, like, Mandela is my great hero. I'm not somebody who believes that reconciliation is a terrible thing. I think reconciliation was the only possible way to move forward for the country in that moment. But in the moment where we are now, we need to turn around and look back. And we need to look back, not just saying, oh gosh, whites are bad and blacks were good. The reality of apartheid is an incredibly complex system that used different people for different reasons. And we need to understand the whole complexity of that system in order to be free to build a country that actually really serves the interests of most people, and not as it is now, which is the interests of very few. I mean, I don't know if I answered your question. Yeah. Yeah, yeah. Yeah, I certainly think the character, I mean, so my understanding of the name Ayanda is to, like, become more. So normally Ayanda Mantombazan means, like, if you have one daughter and then you have a second daughter, so the second daughter will be called Ayanda, or son or whatever. I think it is, I think the character absolutely does grow. I think that the character by the end of the movie is free to let go of things because she now understands them. You know, like during the course of the movie, she couldn't get rid of her father's car. She couldn't get rid of anything from her father. But she was holding on to things because she hadn't dealt with them. Once you deal with them, you can let them go.
We have been watching the film as opener for this festival here in Frankfurt. My question goes toward how was the reception of the film in South Africa? How did the South African public actually appreciate it? How were the reactions, given that you say that it's rather metaphoric for a non having dealt with in South African society with apartheid, not really being worked or dealt with in South African society, so the reception of the of your film in South Africa?
This film didn't play very widely in South Africa. It had a very short run. I think most audiences around the world, but especially in a country like South Africa, Most audiences go to cinema to escape. So when they go to cinema, they don't want to engage and they don't want to think. They want to take away the reality rather than engage with the reality. So it wasn't played widely in South Africa. But those that saw it, I mean, the reception that I got was great. I mean, I got so much great feedback from young people who were so thrilled to see themselves in this way, as opposed to, you know, the way when we made this film, in the middle of making the film, I realized, oh gosh, there's no drugs, no guns, and no violence. You know, actually, there's a little bit of, there's one joint where she smokes a joint, so there's a little bit of drugs. But you know, this movie it's not a movie about car chases or guns, or it's a movie that you have to engage with. I mean, I think it's a difficult movie. Thank you very much.
Yeah, maybe so I can follow with a question about the situation in Africa, or how is it to make films in South Africa now? Because you were telling me that the independent films movement, it has become more stronger. So yeah. I guess there are more films dealing with not this kind of problem, but any similar problems. So there is the industry, or there are some productions that are going on. So maybe
I think I think what's going on in cinema in South Africa at the moment is really exciting, because the government has put a lot of money in films. So a lot of the funding for this film actually comes from the government, which is kind of interesting. But the government invests in films on a rebate system. So that means they don't worry about what the subject of the film is. If you it's like a cash. If you spend so much money, they give you back so much money. So they don't care what the subject is. And in a way, that's freed a lot of filmmakers to make the films that they want to make. So like in the independent filmmaking world in South Africa, there are a lot of new, different voices, young voices, older voices, black voices, color. There's just so many new voices emerging that are people who've been given the opportunity to make their films by these government rebates. And I think over the next while you'll start seeing the quality of South African films increasing and increasing because of this thing, because of the government support for film. So being a filmmaker in South Africa right now is very exciting. I am involved in an organization of women filmmakers in South Africa, and I think that, you know, what we are really fighting for is women's voices to be represented more and more in film and television. Because, you know, in South Africa is a very violent country. There's a lot of violence. And in a country with so much violence, I think you need female voices. you need voices that don't necessarily, and I'm not saying all male voices, but many male voices glorify violence, and female voices tend to gaze more closely not at the mechanics of the violence, but at the effect of the violence. And I think in a country like ours, it's really important to have those voices. And yeah, I think that's, there are more and more of us, and that's also very exciting to me.
Maybe I can ask about the protagonist. How did you find her? Because she's really strong in this film. Not only her, but of course, she's one of the main characters.
So. Yeah. So this is actually her first movie. She hasn't made a movie before. She's a young actress who's just recently finished acting school. And then, oh yeah, then she went and she lived in, I think, Hong Kong for 2 years, working in a big production of Lion King. So this is really her first movie. And yeah, I feel so grateful. I think she's such a great actress.
Any more question?
Yeah, thank you very much for the movie. I enjoyed very much. I have a question. You compared the reconciliation, that it was not done properly or it should continue. How does it match with the current situation of ANC right now? I mean, shouldn't that party actually the one pushing it further to discuss it? It's not really the conservative. So how does this... I'm trying to understand.
Okay. So what's happening right now in the ANC is there is a real split, like literally down the middle. So half of the ANC supports the president, supports Zuma, and those are more corrupt. So those are people who benefit from the corruption system that's in place. And on the other side are people who want to get rid of them, who actually, many of them come from a tradition of working in unions and working in civil society through apartheid. And I think we're standing on the point where the future of the country will be determined by who wins that battle. So, I mean, it's a funny situation because it's not a national election. It's a party election. And the party election, in my opinion, this is my opinion, but that will determine the future of the country. And that thing will happen this year. So in this year will be the year when a decision is made which side of the ANC will win. And I agree, the future of the country is not coming from outside the ANC at the moment. Although, like in Johannesburg, in the last election, they just elected a mayor from one of the outside parties. And he has been so popular, this mayor. So this is not an ANC mayor. This is a mayor from a party called the DA. And he's been literally so this week. There was a big scandal in Johannesburg because the health minister did something completely terrible and all these mental patients, you know, patients with mental problems died. I think there were 100 patients who died. And the mayor fired the guy responsible. Well, that hasn't happened in South Africa in 20 years. You know, that a politician must take responsibility for something that happens. So that is an exciting, I'm giving you way too much detail, but it is an exciting development in internal South African politics. No. I mean, so the corruption in the top level of government is huge. So literally, there are some, in fact, they're actually Indian businessmen who literally control the president. So when the president appointed new ministers or fired ministers, those people were called to these businessmen's house and offered the job before the country was told. I mean, the level of corruption is huge because South Africa is a wealthy country. So it's millions and millions and millions of euros. It's not... I mean, it's not little tiny corruption. I think there are no more questions.
Yes. Okay, thank you for coming.
Thank you for having me.